In the coming 30 minutes, I'll be speaking about how we deployed Kubernetes in production and the challenges we faced and the techniques we used to overcome those. I'm Rahul Mahale, a FOSS enthusiast, currently working as an DevOps engineer at BigBinary and currently shipping containers to production. I firmly believe in principle infrastructure as in code, and we at BigBinary are Kubernetes service provider partner, and that is my Twitter handle. Apart from that, I love playing and watching cricket, and Abby de Villiers is one of my favorite players. Okay, so yeah, the containers, Docker, Kubernetes are the buzzwords, or serverless. So I'll be telling most probably on how to directly deploy applications on production using Kubernetes. So we'll see how to like clustered provisioning considerations for production using Kubernetes, high-level requirements for any orchestration tool, and deploying applications on Kubernetes. So yeah, Docker is cool. Docker pool is really easy, and running a base image or running anything into Docker is really easy. But running a Docker in production is really not that easy. It takes a lot of efforts to run your production-ready app on any orchestration tool, maybe Docker, Docker Swarm, Kubernetes, Apache, Mesos Marathon, or any other container engine. So we'll see how Kubernetes does that. So prerequisite for this talk, so I assume you all know about a Docker and Dockerization of application. Okay, first thing, how many of you use actually Kubernetes or any other orchestration, container orchestration tool in production? Oh, cool, in production. And how many of you use Docker? Okay, that's good, almost 30-40%. So yeah, that's the right job. So I assume you know Dockerization of application or a containerization of app. If you don't know, don't worry. Watch a latest talk from DockerCon Europe where they have introduced Docker application converter. Just run a single command and your complete server, your existing traditional server will be Dockerized. So that is one thing was latest release from Docker Foundation or a Docker community. Then also I assume that you know about various tools, orchestration tools of Docker, like Docker Swarm, maybe Google Container Engine, ECS, some of the vendor tools, or Apache Mesos, or anything. This talk is going to be focused mostly on Kubernetes. So some of the high-level requirements of any orchestration tool, first thing is Docker host, a server might be on a bare metal or on public cloud, which has container runtime installed, maybe a Docker or any other equivalent variant. Then a storage for that container, maybe your volumes, if you are using a host volume, if you are mounting it, your storage should be available for that host. And then obviously a network to communicate with your host and over the cluster. Then some of the features for Docker orchestration tool we want while running containers in production is handling user authentication and authorization. If we are deploying multiple applications on any of the orchestration tools, we need to isolate and give a right access to users. Then how to expose services. With containerization, we don't actually have assigned public IPs to your services or load balancers. Yes, we do have load balancers and there is a service type of load balancer, but one orchestration tool should be intelligent enough to bind your application URL with the services and expose them publicly or internally. Then how to access legacy backends? The stateful sets and persistent volume storage also comes, is the important part of any orchestration tool. And resource management and isolation of different users and teams, and handling highly availability, backup, and restore, meaning that if you are running your application on container orchestration platform, you have to have it highly available and fault tolerant. Okay, first thing, when we dockerize our application, it has to be an image. Either it is your application image or like whatever you have to dockerize, it has to be image so that you can pull and run. So where to get the best image? You should follow the best practices to write your Docker file and build your Docker images. That has to be used in your application deployment on production. So how to handle multi-arc builds? There are some image distributions which are specifically for Docker, like Alpine image, CoreOS image. You can get out from your Debian or Red Hat based architecture and use them and tune your performance for image building. Then how to scan the images for any existing vulnerabilities. When you are building an image, as of now from Docker Hub or from Qwe, they by default provide a vulnerability scanner. They will tell you that this image or this package has the vulnerability and you need to fix them. So keeping that in our deployment pipeline is important thing. And the important thing, where to host the images, either on public registry or if it is a private registry, we have to host it on like self-hosted or a public hosted. So that's up to the user which one to use. And configuration management, like how to store the secrets, the sensitive information, encrypt them, and how to provide them to containers or pods when they actually need it for application usage. Logging is important part of any of the application, and we should consider implementing a better logging management for running containers when we are actually running it in production. And yeah, monitoring wherever you go, either you are on your traditional server architecture or on containers, one needs monitoring. So we need a detailed monitoring so that we can take actually a call about anything like scaling, auto scaling, and all that stuff. So these are some of the features one needs from container orchestration tool, and Kubernetes is one of them which is rich in having all these features. So as I mentioned, every orchestration tool is opinionated when it comes to describing a containerized application. So it's up to user if you have to use Kubernetes, if you have to use Docker Swarm, or if you have to use Mesos, ACS, or ECS. So this talk is mainly focused on Kubernetes. Okay, so before going further, I would like to brief you about Kubernetes architecture and what are the important components are present in Kubernetes. So Kubernetes consists of two parts, master nodes and kubelet nodes. So master are responsible for maintaining a Kubernetes cluster and the health of Kubernetes cluster. On master, we first of all, it might be on any public cloud provider, bare metal, the VMs, anywhere. And when we provision a master, it has etcd. Etcd is a persistent storage database, a key value store database from CoreOS, which has health of complete Kubernetes cluster. So all the configuration related to Kubernetes are in etcd database. Then there is control manager. Control manager is responsible for maintaining a desired state of configuration. How much pods to spin up, what is the deployment state, what is the replication controller for the certain kind of manifest. For these all activities, control manager is responsible and it takes care of that. Control manager runs on master node. Then there is kube scheduler, which schedules the pods, meaning that if new pod is spun up, kube scheduler will take care of scheduling it on a certain node which is healthy and can accumulate that pod which can run the pod in healthy state. And there is API server using which you can interact with Kubernetes resources. Kubectl is one of the command line tool using which you can interact with Kubernetes and you can create and delete resources using Kubectl. Also you can use REST API and other tools. You can directly connect to REST API and like create and delete resources from Kubernetes. So this is all about master node. On the nodes, on the kubelet nodes where actually your application runs. So there has to be any container runtime environment or Docker. Docker is one of the famous, but with Kubernetes 1.8 version, we support multiple container runtime environments, might be a Rocket or some CRIO. So Docker is one of them. Then there is a kubelet. Kubelet is a process which keeps running all the containers or pods on the node, and it is responsible for sending a heartbeat message to master that this node is healthy. So kubelet is one of the important component of the Kubernetes node. And kubeproxy is also used to say that we can say that it is a service discovery mechanism of Kubernetes, and it actually routes the traffic based on IPs to the containers and pods. So the master node consists of etcd, API service, scheduler control, and kubelets, where our application runs consist of kubelet, container runtime environment, and kubeproxy. So before deploying application, we have to know some of the terminologies of Kubernetes, and I won't describe them in detail, but just to say about pods, which are like a low-level abstraction layer of Kubernetes, and every container in Kubernetes is termed as pod. A pod can contain more than one container, and all the containers in same pod are in same namespace and are scheduled on single host. Then deployments, those are supervisor to the pods, and they maintain a state of all the containers assigned, meaning that if we have scheduled to run two replicas of a container, the deployment is responsible to make them up. If one of the container goes down, deployment controller will take care of spinning it up and make the all the two replicas up and running. Services are the abstraction layer of Kubernetes, using which we can actually communicate through the applications. Services can be of two or three types. One is cluster IP services, using which we can communicate within a cluster, the load balancer service, and via external IP service, using which we can access our application over the public or over the internet. Config maps are a way to decouple your configuration files from actually Docker image. So if you have to change your any configuration file, maybe a database.yaml from your application, you don't have to go through a complete deployment configuration. Just use it as a configuration map, change the config map, and just trigger the pod. The change will be automatically deployed to your application without building an image and going through complete deployment lifecycle. Then secrets. So we have to have a way to encrypt our secrets and sensitive information. So Kubernetes has Kubernetes secrets. Till Kubernetes version 1.7, they don't provide actual encrypted secrets. They were just base64. But with Kubernetes 1.8 version, now we have encrypted secrets, and we can store our data in secrets and all the sensitive information, which can be retrieved over deployment for pod or application usage. Then jobs. For a periodic tasks or for custom tasks, we need jobs. Till that, it was easy. We could just log into our application server, SSH, or login, run few commands, and that's it. But as containers or pods are immutable, we don't actually have to all the time log into our containers. So instead, use jobs. Jobs will execute the task, they'll complete, and they'll terminate the pod. So we have to know about Kubernetes jobs as well. Scheduled jobs are nothing but they are cron jobs scheduled to run on specific time. And there is important thing, horizontal pod autoscaler. HPA autoscales automatically when there is need of autoscaling. Currently it supports CPU based autoscaling, meaning that if you have specified 80% of CPU usage to scale up, Kubernetes will automatically add more replicas and maintain a healthy state of application. So Kubernetes supports horizontal pod autoscaling. So two grounds when we have to deploy application on container platform like Kubernetes. First is provisioning production ready Kubernetes cluster, which can be managed by your cluster operator, who has to come up with the production ready Kubernetes cluster. And second is deploying application on the Kubernetes cluster. So if you want to go for any vendor Kubernetes cluster, there are multiple cloud providers who offer it. GK is one of them, who offers Kubernetes based cluster. But if you are provisioning of your own, because most of, as per the survey, more than 60% of people run their own Kubernetes cluster on a public cloud like AWS or on bare metal. So it's important to know like what all things has to be taken care of when you deploy your Kubernetes cluster. So when we have to deploy our Kubernetes cluster, first it must be highly available, meaning that we don't have to have any downtime in any case. We should be having multi-master Kubernetes cluster. Then secured must be behind VPN and secure networking, and auto scalable, meaning that we don't have to over provision whenever we need the more resources. Our cluster must automatically add the nodes, and whenever not needed, it should scale down. So where to do it? So provision highly available cluster using KeOps. We mostly run our all the resources on AWS. So KeOps is one of the tool to provision Kubernetes cluster on AWS. It also supports provisioning of cluster on Google Cloud, but it's in alpha. Then we use private networking using Calico. Calico is one of the networking type which Kubernetes offers. There is also Viv, and there is also Flannel. So we use Calico and use cluster at autoscaler Kubernetes add-on from community itself. We have to specify our threshold minimum of 5 hosts, meaning that it will spin up cluster of 5 nodes with minimum 5 nodes and maximum of 20 nodes. If we are specifying 20 nodes, whenever needed, it will add more and more nodes until the 20 nodes are full of capacity. So there is a cluster autoscaler add-on for AWS from community itself. If you want to deploy your cluster on other cloud providers or on bare metal, there are tools like KubeADM, KubeSpray, and also there are some vendor tools like Tectonic from CoreOS and others. So with respect to storage, Kubernetes has persistent volumes, and with AWS it works great as it uses AWS EBS, Elastic Block Storage, and it can be used in your application. Also, you can use NFS storage if you want to scale up and down your persistent volume applications. And host path is one of the way for volatile persistent storage, meaning that when your pod is restarted, the host path type volume, the data will not be stored. Then there are certain options like Gluster File System, Ceph, OpenEBS, and Rook, which are like third-party options. But if you are looking for persistent storage, you can also check them. So the important part, as I said already, that containers are mostly for stateless applications, and we or people don't rely when you want to store your persistent storage data on containers. So first thing is, if you want to run your application on production, where to host services like database. So it is possible, it is really possible with Kubernetes version 1.7 and 1.8 using stateful sets. So one should go and try out stateful sets, and if comfortable, should go for hosting database or backend services on Kubernetes using stateful sets and compact persistent volume. We being on AWS, we used RDS, and it worked great, because RDS is really a great service from AWS, which takes pain of handling database services. So when we launch an application, we have to have our database instance pre-created, and we need automation for that. So yeah, I'll tell you further like how we automated it. The networking is an important part of Kubernetes. KubeNet is a default networking type provided by Kubernetes, and Calico, Flannel, VWorks, or others, you can choose, and you just have to check like which automation tool suits perfect for your networking type. So important thing, first thing is image building. So though I won't be going into complete CI/CD pipeline of deployment, image building is the one I need to like just explain out. So base images, if you are using from public registry, like if your application is PHP, You'll just use public image of PHP with the proper version number, and you could just add your abstraction over that for your application and deploy it. That the image building can also be self-hosted. You can build your images using Jenkins. As with Docker Cloud and other things, they don't provide actually a parallel build image building, meaning that if you are running your image building on same repository, it will queue your image and that can slow your deployment life cycle. So we switch to Jenkins, we use we build image on Jenkins and host it on self-hosted Docker Hub registry. So the generic best practices to follow when you are building images: one layer for base image, one for user configuration, and one for application. Your Docker file must be as small as possible to minimize the Docker image building time. Leverage user directive, and if possible, avoid using a root user directly. Create an application user and perform all your application stuff using that. Ensure regular scanning of images. As I mentioned earlier, Docker Hub already provides a scanning of vulnerabilities. If you aren't using Docker Hub, you should always scan your Docker images and check what are all the vulnerable packages and run CVE or patches for them. And yeah, use environment variables wherever needed. Don't just hard code all your information which is sensitive in Docker files or in your deployment pipeline. So resource management, one of the important part when you are deploying containers. One namespace per user group. So there is a concept called namespaces in Kubernetes, using which you can isolate your resources. So if you are running everything in one namespace, let's say if you are creating app one and you try to create the app with same name in same namespace, it won't create. Instead, create a separate namespace for separate client or separate app, and it will allow you. So one namespace per user or per group is recommendable to keep things in more good way. And also separate namespaces for your environments, maybe development, testing, staging, or build. Then specify resource quota. So let's say we have deployed one of our container in production and it is having memory leaks. So it will go and consume more and more memory, and our autoscaler will keep adding more and more instances to our cluster, which is not an ideal case. So instead, space a memory or a CPU quota, meaning that for this container, the highest limit is 4 core of CPU and 8 GB of memory, or 2 core of CPU and 4 gigs of memory. Whenever the quota is reached, either the container will autoscale if the HPA is added, or it will restart. So specify resource quota in your deployment manifest of Kubernetes. Then authentication and authorization. If you are running multiple applications on single Kubernetes cluster, it is very important to specify a role-based authentication. You have two ways to do that with Kubernetes. One is attribute-based access control, and other is role-based access control. So you can restrict access to the particular Kubernetes or kubectl user for the particular namespace and attributes, meaning that the application user, the application one user, cannot access the data of application two users. So you have to implement all these practices using RBAC. Also, you can do it using webhooks, custom models, or some third-party resources for Kubernetes. Important thing, when we want to deploy any application, that must be zero downtime. So for cluster upgrades, in terms of cluster upgrades, COPS supports out-of-the-box rolling updates for clusters deployed on AWS, and we should ideally go through it and use it, COPS rolling update. But for deployments, if you want to handle application which runs on Kubernetes and should be deployed in zero downtime, there is something called health check, readiness and liveness pros, and container lifecycle hooks. When you deploy your application on Kubernetes, your service checks or just sends an health check to the pod. If you're on port 80, your health check is up, then only it will route your traffic. In that case, if you want to have zero downtime deployment, you have to deploy your application with at least more than two replicas, so that when you deploy, your one pod or your one container is always serving the traffic while other is rebooting or other is doing a rolling deployment. So for that, there is readiness and liveness probe. readiness probe is something that ensures that your pod is actually ready to serve the traffic. Unless and until the success threshold is okay for readiness probe, Kubernetes service will not route traffic to the that pod. And there are some container lifecycle hooks using which you can track your pod lifecycle and make sure that your pod is up and running. Important thing after services, you should check ingress controller, though you have load balancers and Kubernetes supports deployment of application using load balancers. Using ingress has its own advantages. First of all, it uses L7 load balancing, then SSL termination on ingress itself. Also, you can using ingress, you can specify path based tools so that you can specify /abc or /xyz request should directly be routed to this service, and multiple host names. This is all possible with single ingress, which uses Nginx. Then auto scaling of applications on Kubernetes. So as I already mentioned, horizontal pod autoscaler, but as of now only Kubernetes supports only CPU based autoscaling, meaning that you can't scale based on memory or request per seconds. So there is something called memory based autoscaler. I think it's in pipeline and it's not stable in version 9.8. Instead, they have added custom metrics autoscaling. So for memory based autoscaler, we wrote our own memory based autoscaler and it's really easy to write. Just watch out how much your memory is being used. If it is 80%, take a mean of your pods and add more pods, and similarly scale down. There is something interesting called custom metrics autoscaling. So apart from CPU and memory, we might want to scale sometime based on request per seconds or query per seconds or some request count, request counts. So with version 1.7, we have that. We have to create our own third party aggregation layer, meaning that we will create our own API version, and using that we can create custom metrics autoscaling, and that works out of the box with version 1.7. Then Kubernetes jobs, use it for custom and periodic scheduled tasks or unscheduled tasks. If you want to run cron jobs and you are running Kubernetes cluster 1.6, you have to restart your API server with this flag and make sure that your restart policy is on failure, meaning that your pod will be restarted, the same pod will be restarted. If you don't put it and your job is failing, it will keep continuing spinning up new and new pods unless and until your pod is in running state. But your pod or your command is buggy, it won't happen, and Kubernetes has a limit. So Kubernetes can schedule only 100 pods per node, and in a cluster you can have only 5000 nodes. So to prevent these scenarios, we have to take care of such flags. There are some known issues if you are running Kubernetes into production. The ticket number 42164 in upstream Kubernetes repository, your nodes might go into not ready state over and over again if they are like going over requests. To avoid such issues, first thing, if the issue occurs, just SSH into your node and restart your kubelet or docker, but before that drain your node, meaning that just remove all the resources running at on that node. After applying drain to that node, Kubernetes will gracefully move your pods from that node. And important thing, to avoid these scenarios, request must be less than limits, meaning that if you have specified one core of CPU to a certain pod, you should not actually request directly one core right away. Instead, request 50 to 60%, 0.5 core of CPU, or same way the halfway of memory. This will not result in occurring this issue. Other main issue is if you are using persistent volume claims, those deployments or pods are not scalable, because the same volume, at least with AWS and some cloud providers, the same volume cannot be attached to multiple pods. So make sure if your application is scalable, you are not using persistent volume with this kind of. So some of the issues while upgrading your cluster, and if you are using COPS, it might break if you are using Calico networking. So this is known issue. So they have provided one fix, and there's the link for that. also make sure if you are running your production cluster and performing some cluster upgrade, your COPS version is supported for the target Kubernetes version. So meaning that if you have to provision Kubernetes 1.7, you have to use COPS 1.7, which is officially supported version for Kubernetes. So important part, monitoring Kubernetes cluster and applications on you. Hipster and InfluxDB are the add-ons available from community itself, which gives you a monitoring information in TOPS style command using kubectl top nodes or kubectl top pods. But the important thing about monitoring is you can use Prometheus. Prometheus is itself a huge and awesome monitoring tool, and using that you can actually monitor entire cluster and your pod resources. There is a community dashboard available for Grafana and use it. We can use Alert Manager, which can send us alert on Slack, Gmail, anything, or which can also be integrated with PagerDuty. So while deploying Prometheus, make sure your node exporter and Prometheus core has been configured with resources limit, because those two pods tend to consume a lot of resources and can eat up like 10 GB or 12 GB of resources. There are other tools for monitoring as well. You can check Datadog, Sysdig, VueScope, and others. For logging, there is also an add-on called EFK, instead ELK. With Kubernetes, they use Cloud Native Fluentd, which is Elasticsearch Fluentd, and Kibana. And plus that, we use Logtrail. A paper trail style tell, or just if you want to see your all logs in tell format, use Logtrail plugin, which will display all your logs in tell format on browser. So important thing is automation. You can, like, if you want to deploy your application on Kubernetes, you have to come up with your own artifacts or manifest of your Kubernetes templates. Might be a deployment service. So for that, you can use a tool like Ansible, or you can whatever is your best whatever is your favorite language, use that and automate all the stuff. But if you want to automate your deployment flow, Helm is one of the tool from Kubernetes community which manages the deployment releases and zero downtime deployment. If you are more into, like, if you want to develop your own, you can also use Kubernetes API. So also labeling a node, if you want to isolate or schedule some of the nodes on specific nodes, you can check kubectl label nodes or labeling of the nodes in Kubernetes. Using labels, you can assign pods to certain nodes. Backup and restore. As I mentioned already, etcd is the heart of Kubernetes. So if anything is down, if node is down, Kubernetes can recover. If API server is down, we can recover. But if etcd is down, Kubernetes cluster is dead. So we have to be very sure about making etcd is highly available. So we have to take periodic backup of that. And we should at least deploy 3 node etcd cluster on Kubernetes so that we are highly available. Also, there are techniques to take backup of etcd cluster. We can directly take volume backups, but one should consider checking Reshifter, one of the famous tool, and Arc from Heptio, which are like etcd or Kubernetes cluster backup and restore tools. Also, enable transport layer security for Kubernetes. Some of the tools when you are deploying your Kubernetes, kubeval is the single, it's a validation tool for your YAML templates. Then Kubernetes dashboard to view your cluster and health, Hipster and kubestat metrics to check the resources of your pods and what all they are consuming. So apart from that, it's been months we are running Kubernetes in production. Yes, there are some times that things don't work. But yeah, the community is awesome, and we can say that Kubernetes really rocks, and we have simplified our deployment process, and we are using it effectively, which has helped us in reducing cost as well as deployment time. So yeah, questions?
Cool, let's limit it to two questions as well. Okay, one.
Since it uses etcd as the background store, have you run into any issues with the distributed nature of it, and that sometimes your truth is not true, like you have too many nodes down or something like that?
Okay, so you mean when we are running multi-node etcd cluster,
yeah.
We run into issues that something isn't consistent.
Yeah, okay. Consistency problems. So it uses Raft, I think.
You face this issue?
No, I'm just wondering if you do run into issues.
Okay, so first thing, if we are running 3-node or more than 3-node etcd cluster, etcd manages its own health. And if there is a restart of one of the node, etcd will manage the node which is restarting. The other two nodes will take up the cluster configuration and they'll keep it running. And whenever the third node is added, it will be added using a flag called existing or new state. When you are starting etcd, there is one flag called start a cluster with existing, that is with existing state or new state. So by default, the highly availability structure is with existing cluster, and whenever the node is like restarted, it doesn't affect the health of the cluster. So if you want to avoid these scenarios, and I think etcd is a complex part about Kubernetes, you should consider learning some etcd/ctl commands. So that might help. If you run into issues, you can just say like etcd add member, etcd remove member, and all that.